Harper Audio presents The Tower by Simon Toyne, performed by Simon Vance. To Stan. Sorry, there are no pirates in it. Part 1. All things are full of gods. Plato. Prologue. The basement is dark and quiet. A figure, stripped to the waist and kneeling, takes the blade in his right hand and draws it across the skin at the joint of his left arm and shoulder, tracing the scar of a previous cut. The blade is sharp, and the scar opens easily, letting blood run down skin, quivering at the bite of the knife. "The first," he says, his voice low in the darkness. "This blood binds me in pain with the sacrament. As it suffers, so must I, until all suffering will end." He switches the blade to his left hand and repeats the cut on his right shoulder. "The second," he says, continuing the ritual learned from a hospital worker in the southern Turkish city of Ruin, a man loyal to the cause who had faithfully recorded everything the dying Sanctus said through their delirium and suffering. The knife continues to cut, drawing fresh blood from old wounds, carving the same pattern he has seen on the bodies of the sacred monks, captured on a camera phone by the same spy after their suffering had finally ended. It is a ceremony that remained secret and locked in the Citadel at the heart of Ruin for thousands upon thousands of years. The enemies of the Church believe that the death of the Sancti and the breaching of the Citadel mark the end of the old ways. They are wrong. When the ceremony is over, he cleanses his wounds, flushing them with saline solution before drying them and sealing them with superglue that stings as it binds the flesh back together. The pain sharpens his mind, and so does its purpose. Only through suffering can redemption be reached, and only through sacrifice can the enemy be beaten. He dresses quickly, buttoning his high-collared shirt to hide the scar on his neck and fixing his tie. Only a very few know him by the name he wears down here in the dark. Novus Sancti, Keeper of the Sacred Flame. But he is not alone in the shadows. There are others, many others like him, who have devoted themselves to the silent and secret protection of God's sacred mission on earth. They are everywhere, woven into the fabric of society, lawmakers, politicians, opinion formers, the crosses around their necks, the only sign that they serve a higher law than those of the lands they live in. They are legion, for they are many, an army waiting to be mobilized when Judgment Day draws near. And that time is now. He knows this to be true, for he has seen the signs and felt the call inside him. God has spoken to him, and now he will answer. He slips on his jacket, then mounts the stairs back up into the modern world, like a man rising from the dead, reborn, renewed, ready. Chapter 1. Meriwether looked up at the bank of screens. Something was wrong. He glanced behind him, though he knew he was alone in the control center. Everyone else was at the interdepartmental party they threw each year to mark the start of the Christmas holidays. Meriwether wasn't big on parties. He didn't drink and couldn't do small talk, so he volunteered for the caretaker watch to garner some points with colleagues on the flight ops team and bag a little heavy-duty processor time to crunch the deep space data he was working on for his PhD. He leaned forward in his chair and cocked his head to one side, listening to the chatter of the hard drive. Some people could listen to a car engine and tell you what was wrong with it. Others might hear one bum note in a symphony played by a 60-piece orchestra. Meriwether knew computers, and this one definitely sounded hinky. There was a hitch in the processing tone, like a broken tooth on a clock wheel, or a fresh scratch on one of the classic 45s he liked to collect. He stroked his knitted tie nervously as he considered what to do. Unlike the other techs at the Goddard Space Center, Meriwether was strictly old school. He wore a tie every day, along with pressed trousers, horn-rimmed glasses, and neatly combed hair, just like his boyhood heroes, the Houston mission controllers of the 60s and 70s. He also liked rules and order. He didn't like it when things went wrong. A tap on his keyboard banished the Pillars of Creation screensaver, the most famous image taken by the Hubble telescope, controlled from this room and currently orbiting Earth, 353 miles above Meriwether's head. He ran through the standard checklist of the latest telemetry. Temperature normal, speed steady, all systems green, no fluctuation in the solar wind, nothing abnormal. He typed in a string of commands, and the big screen on the wall flashed an updated image from the main reflector feed. It showed the luminous swirl of Cosmos Aztec 6, 13.4 billion light-years away, the farthest system ever observed from Earth. The processor crunched again, making Meriwether wince. Then something happened that he had never seen before. An application auto-loaded onto his desktop, a large window filled with numbers.
"Virus," he said. "We have a virus."
No response. No one there. The numbers remained on screen for a few seconds, then disappeared. Meriwether tapped the keyboard and shook the mouse. He kicked back, rolling his chair away from the desk and across the floor to another workstation. Same thing. Frozen screen, frozen keyboard. The processors chattered feverishly as they continued to feed on whatever digital poison had somehow found its way into the pristine system. The main screen flickered and Meriwether looked up. The image was beginning to shift and disintegrate. Whatever had locked him out was now taking control of the guidance systems. The telescope was moving. He fumbled for a desk phone, knocking the receiver to the floor, pulling it up by the cord and stabbing a button marked Dr. Kinderman, cell phone. On the screen, the image continued to break up as the telescope turned. In his ear, the ringing tone began. Somewhere down the hall, a marimba tune rang in sync with it. Meriwether clamped the phone under his chin and went through every reboot command he could think of to try and unlock the keyboard. Nothing. The ringing tone continued in his ear. He dropped the phone on the desk and launched himself toward the exit. Outside in the corridor, the marimba was louder. It was coming from Kinderman's office. He arrived at the door, knocked once out of habit, then opened it. The state of the office came as a complete shock. Wrenched open drawers, papers everywhere, books all over the floor. The cell phone was on the desk. It shimmered a couple of times, vibrating in time to the ring, then stopped. In the silence that followed, Meriwether heard the crunch of the pernicious code coming from Kinderman's terminal. He moved cautiously into the room, wading through drifts of paper, until the monitor came into view. He stopped dead when he saw the message on the screen. "Mankind must look no further." Chapter 2. Shepherd took a deep breath, then let it out slowly, trying not to make a sound as he edged forward down the dark corridor, gun first toward the solitary door. It was open slightly, the splintered timbers around the lock, evidence of how many times it had been kicked in over the years. Somewhere above him in the Virginia winter, wind moaned through broken windows, filling the derelict townhouse with whispering voices. It was too below outside, probably colder in here, but he was sweating beneath his body armor. He stopped a foot short of the door and leaned against the wall, feeling the flex in the plasterboard and timber frame. Not much good for stopping bullets. He hunkered down below eye level like he'd been taught, and slipped his scoping mirror from his belt, then past the edge of the door jamb. Daylight leaked in through high, narrow windows, sketching the outline of a room. Another door set into the far wall, a table in the center spilling over with various items. A man and a woman standing directly behind it. The skin tightened on Shepard's scalp. The man's eyes, framed by safety goggles, seemed to be staring straight at him. He saw a hand clamp tighter across the face of the terrified woman, held in front of him like a shield, saw the other hand rising up. He leaped away just as gunfire shattered the cold silence and bullets smacked into the wall where he had been resting. He rolled into a new position farther down the corridor and leveled his gun at the door.
"FBI," he shouted, "drop your weapon and come out slowly with your hands on your head. We have the building surrounded."
Not true. He was a lone agent following a cold lead that had just gone volcanic. He heard noises coming from the room, something clattering to the floor, then footsteps scuffing away. He moved forward in a crouch, gun just below his line of sight, free hand reaching for a stun grenade on his belt. He pulled the pin and tossed it around the doorframe. The grenade clattered across the floor, clanged against the metal leg of the table, then detonated with a lightning flash that Shepard saw even behind his closed eyelids. A sharp, percussive boom shook the wall and he was up and into the room. No one there. Far door open. He ran through the white magnesium smoke, performing a quick inventory of the table as he passed. 9-volt batteries, wire cutters, soldering iron, duct tape, vacuum packs of plastique. Bomb-making equipment. The smart move would be to regroup and call for backup. But the suspect knew he was cornered. He had fired shots and fled even after Shepard had identified himself as FBI. He was desperate and therefore unpredictable. And he had a hostage. If Shepard waited for other units to show, the suspect would probably kill the woman and make a run for it. But right now he was vulnerable, his ears ringing from the pressure wave of the grenade, his eyes useless in the gloom of the basement. Shepard had the advantage, but it was slight and wouldn't last for more than the next few seconds. He had to make a choice. He took a breath and swept his gun arm around the edge of the doorframe, following it into the second room. The suspect was in the far corner, backed up against the wall, the hostage still in front of him and terrified. Shepard stood square on, maximizing the cover of his body armor, his gun steady in a good two-hand hold, trying to fix the front sight on what he could see of the suspect's face. With his peripheral vision, he sucked in the detail of the room, a single mattress on the floor, a low table next to it, a movie poster tacked to the wall with a burnt orange sun and slashed white lettering. His mouth went dry as buried memories rushed out of his past. The dank smell. The same sun on the same poster, a room just like this. He tried to zone it all out, keeping his eyes on the suspect and his mind on the here and now. But the sun kept pulling at him with something like real gravity, dragging him back to that dark, dark place he had done everything he could to forget. His hand began to tremble. The suspect was shouting, but he couldn't make out what he was saying. Then he saw a hand rise up, something in it, some kind of button with a wire trailing down to the belt bomb wound around the hostage's neck. Behind them, the sun blazed on the wall like an omen of the explosion to come. Shepard felt weak. He couldn't hold it together. His whole world condensed to the end of his gun, and the suspect's face came into focus along with the words on the movie poster. Apocalypse now. He pulled the trigger. Adjusted for recoil, everything muscle memory now, drilled in deep from hours on the range, squeezed off another round, saw an explosion of red beyond his gun sight. Then he watched in silence as both suspect and hostage fell in crumpled slow motion to the ground. In the stillness that followed, Shepard felt everything drain out of him. His eyes drifted back to the molten sun. His hand dropped to his side, the red-handled gun dangling from his curled trigger finger. He didn't even feel the instructor take it from him, or register the fluorescent lights flicking into life above his head. In his mind, he was still back there, staring at the same poster on a different wall. The room where she had found him, and they had saved each other.
Shepard? The voice seemed to come from very far away. Shepard, you okay?
The granite face of Special Agent Williams slid into view, obscuring the poster and breaking the spell.
Shepard blinked. Nodded.
You made some tactical errors.
He nodded again.
Get yourself over to the biograph for a debrief.
The practical applications instructor slapped him on the back with a hand made solid from years of pulling triggers and turned to the two actors, already on their feet and tugging wet wipes from their pockets to clean away the red dye from Shepard's training pistol. They each had an impact mark on their foreheads, just above the eye. Kill shots, both.
Back to initial positions, Williams barked. Next trainee coming through in 5.
Chapter 3. Shepard stepped out of the front door of the townhouse into the teeth of a westerly wind straight off Chesapeake Bay and headed away along Main Street. Hogan's Alley covered 10 acres of the Marine base in Quantico and was built as a microcosm of any town America, with its own bank, drugstore, hotel, gas station. Basically all the institutions criminals targeted out in the real world. Normally the whole town echoed with radio buzz, shouted orders and the crackle of gunfire from FBI, DEA, and other assorted law enforcement officers as they learned the art of urban tactical deployment. Today it was almost deserted, like everywhere else, as the whole base wound down for the Christmas holidays. Shepard noticed a stuffed...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.